Welcome to Good Game Spawn Point, the show for gamers by gamers. I'm Hex.
And I'm Barjo.
And I am Darren.
Coming up on the show, we get some air and kickflip our way through Ollie Ollie.
Sick tricks, Hex. We'll also load up those portal goo guns and solve some tricky levels in Aperture Tag.
Well, now it's time for Darren's question of the week.
Affirmative, Hex. Tune up your grey matter, spawnlings. It's time for Darren's challenge. This week I'm asking, who is the Disney Infinity villain behind this silhouette?
Darren, I do declare that to be a tricky one.
Well, here's a little hint for the noobs. The villain has crazy hair.
Well, while we ponder the answer to that, here's Goose with the news.
Thanks, guys. Goose here with all the gaming news from around the globe. Earth's tallest mountain, Mount Everest, has been fully recreated in Minecraft. Using a number of geographical mapping tools, a user named ImBillyO was able to generate a realistic replica of Everest and its surrounding landscape. ImBillyO then moved the collected geographical data into Minecraft with impressive results. This same technique could one day be used to map the entire globe in Minecraft. And Australia's soccer team has won the World Cup in Brazil. Hang on, that can't be right. It was their robotic counterparts. Yes, that's right, 20 teams of athletic robots from across the globe converged in Brazil for RoboCup 2014. But it was the University of New South Wales who took the top prize. Their team, Run Swift, thrashed Germany in the grand final, winning 5-1. That's some crafty robotic footwork. And that's all the news for this week. Back to you guys.
Thanks, Goose. All right, guys, it's time to kickflip a 360 with a 50-50 heel flip sideways in Ollie Ollie.
Ollie Ollie is a 2D side-scrolling skateboarding indie game. It was released for the Vita earlier this year, but since it was also released recently on PC, we thought we'd check it out.
You control your skater by pushing to gain speed, and then performing a series of jumps, flips, grinds, and spins to try and rack up as many points as you can.
Affirmative, Barjo. There are several locations to skate your way through, including the port, the streets, and my favourite, the junkyard! There are also a variety of challenges to keep you on the edge of your board.
Yeah, some of those challenges were pretty tricky to complete. I found the difficulty in this game was absolutely spot on, though.
I agree. It's a tough but fair system. It can be hard to pull off some of those long combos, but when you nail them, it feels so rewarding. I also found the tutorials excellent.
Yeah, me too. And the levels add more complex structures at just the right moments, too. The first level has a few grinds and jumps, but before you know it, you'll be completing whole levels in a single combo.
One thing we should mention is that this game is much easier to play if you plug a controller into your PC, which the game actually recommends that you do.
Yes, that's right, Darren. We did try it with a keyboard and mouse, but the moves just feel much more fluid and more intuitive with a controller.
Your jumps and grinds are performed with the left thumbstick, but to score those extra points, you have to time your landing perfectly.
Yeah, it's a great example of an easy-to-learn but tough-to-master task. One thing I really liked was the music. Skating along to dubstep feels just right.
Did you say dubstep? Womp womp. Womp womp.
All right, Darren. Womp. Naturally, you can move from level to level as you unlock them. Womp. But it's not until you've completed all the challenges on the amateur tracks that you can unlock the pro tracks.
Yeah, I was determined to complete all of the challenges, even though some of them were crazy tough.
Yeah, me too. I also liked how it made you look into the Trictionary to expand your trick vocabulary.
Sick frontside Nolly McTwist, Hex.
Toad's fat. But what are you going to give it, Hex?
Well, there's some really fun boarding in this game, and nailing those super long combos is just so satisfying, so I'm giving it 8 out of 10.
This reminded me a lot of those old Tony Hawk games, which is a good thing. Tight controls, good soundtrack, and a reasonable price too, so I'm going to give it 8.5 out of 10.
What's the best skateboarding move you can do, Darren?
Well, I've recently mastered the Noob Destroyer Flip 9000.
What? That sounds impressive.
No, it's quite the spectacle.
Darren, why don't you do it for us now?
Yeah.
I'd love to, but you see, I can only do it on Mars because of the lower gravity.
Right. Do you even skateboard, Darren?
Of course I can. But anyway, moving along, it's time for the last lesson in game making from Goose and Julian. Are you ready?
I am ready.
Ready.
Now.
Roll the tape, Kerry.
Hello and welcome to the final lesson in our series on making your very own game with me, Goose, and Julian. Thanks for joining us again, Julian.
My pleasure, Goose.
In the past 5 lessons, we've taken you into the depths of Scratch, an animation and game-making tool, and we've put together our Good Game Spawn Point Invaders game, but it's still missing something.
That's because there's no sound yet.
Ah, yes, of course. Now, before getting started, you'll have to download the sound effects, which can be found on our website here. Now that you've got those, open up Scratch and Julian, fire away with the first step.
Today we'll put the finishing touches on the game, including sounds. First, select the Darren Laser Sprite and click on the Sounds tab. Click on Upload Sound from File and upload the Baggio Owl sound. Then use the same method to upload the Hex Owl and Goose Owl sounds.
Select the Scripts tab and place 3 new if-then loops inside the first if-then loop just below the block that increases the score by 1. Move the Hide and Go To Darren blocks out of the way and replace them below with the 3 new if-then loops.
From Sensing, add 3 touching blocks, 1 in each if loop, and assign them to Baggio, Hex and Goose. Then from Sounds, insert Play Sound Baggio, Play Sound Hex, and Play Sound Goose, each one in its appropriate if loop.
Done!
Now select the Baggio Chicken Sprite. Under Sounds, select Upload Sound from File, and select the Darren Owl sound. Now go to Scripts, and click on Sound. Just below the block that reduces Darren's lives by 1, insert a play sound block and select the sound Darren Owl. Do exactly the same for the Hex and Goose Chicken sprites.
If you like, you can use the Darren Oh Dear and Darren Scared sounds for the other chicken sprites to add variety. Now for the laser and chicken firing sound effects. Select Darren's laser sprite. Click on the Sounds tab. Click on Upload Sound from File and upload the Laser Shot WAV file. Click on the Scripts tab. Below the Show block, insert a Play Sound block from Sounds and set it to Laser Shot. Now select Baggio's Chicken Sprite. Click on the Sounds tab, click on Upload Sound from File and upload the Chicken Squawk file. Click on the Scripts tab. Below the Show block, insert a Play Sound block from Sounds and set it to Chicken Squawk. Now do the same for the Hex and Goose Chicken Sprites. Ow! Ow! Done! It worked! Now the game has sound too. I can't believe we actually did it, Julian.
Believe it, Goose. Anyone can learn to program. Now that you've made your first game, you can make more. There are loads of examples of Scratch games on the official Scratch website. Download them, play around with them. Get new ideas for your own games. Try new things.
Oh, I'm looking forward to it. Well, thank you, Spawnlings, for joining us on this epic adventure to make our very own game. Remember, for all the past lessons, information on Scratch and extra resources, you can find them on our website.
Here.
Thanks for all your help, Julian.
No worries, Goose. Shall we have a game?
Oh, yes, let's. You go first.
Okay.
Wow. Oh, watch out for the lasers. Ooh. Ow.
Well, that was the last lesson in the series, so thank you so much to Goose and Julian for teaching us how to make our very own game.
Yes, it was brilliant, wasn't it? Keep up the coding, Spawnlings, and hopefully we'll make some more lessons in the future.
Okay, it's off to our spawn point now. Off you go.
All right, Baggio, let's get this question train a-rollin'. And speaking of trains, let's go with this one from Train Guy Will I Am, who is in Melbourne, Victoria. To GGSP. The week Baggio went to E3, you said you were going to review a train game. But, you did not! So, what was the name of it and why did you not review it? If you don't answer this question, I will maybe become the noobiest noob in the whole wide world. Faces for you. That spells Amy. Me out. Will I am.
Well, Will I am, I wasn't here, so I actually have no idea. Explain yourself, Hex.
You see, the game was called A Train 9, and we were originally going to review it because we saw it had just been released digitally, and we figured it was a new game. But then we found out that it was actually released all the way back in 2010.
Well, that would be a bit weird to review a game so far back when there are plenty of new games to look at, wouldn't it?
Yeah, so we decided to take a look at Kiwanuka instead.
It does happen occasionally, where we say we'll be looking at one game, but for one reason or another, we might decide to go with something else. Maybe it's just not very good, or maybe we find another game that we think might be more interesting for you. Lots of reasons.
Hmm. Although, Badge, we've never really looked at a train simulator before, have we?
No, we haven't, Hex. And I think that's mostly because they're usually a bit on rails. Get it? Because trains are on rails, and sometimes games can be on rails.
I get it, Badger.
Because they're a bit... Well, you're not laughing, Hex.
Well, that's because it's a terrible pun, and puns aren't funny.
Aren't funny? Don't you mean aren't punny?
Ugh. Okay, moving on now to this one from Totoro Freak, who is behind you in Victoria.
Hi, GGSP. I was wondering if there are any Studio Ghibli video games coming out, like Totoro, Kiki's Delivery Service, The Cat Returns, etc. I watch you guys every chance I get to. I think Make a Game was a really good idea. I've got three questions. One, are there going to be any more Avengers games? Two, how do you make an end portal in Minecraft? Three, how many mods are there in Minecraft and which one is most popular? P.S. Bajo, do these faces. Oh, here we go. Totoro, freak out!
Well, Totoro Freak, sorry to say, but we haven't heard any news about upcoming Studio Ghibli games.
But there was, of course, Ni no Kuni, which isn't based on any Studio Ghibli film, but instead is an entirely original game co-created with Studio Ghibli.
It really does look and feel like a Ghibli film, doesn't it? Mm. Except it's an epic RPG that lasts for about 50 hours. Awesome.
Yeah, it's a great game, but it's only available on PS3, so hopefully you have one of those.
Mm. Actually, it did come out for the DS, except only in Japan, so unless you can speak and read Japanese, we wouldn't recommend trying to hunt down that version.
Mm. There was also a game I saw at E3 that had a very Studio Ghibli kind of vibe called Ori and the Blind Forest. It looked promising, and it's meant to be coming out towards the end of the year for Xbox One and PC.
Hmm. As for there being any more Avengers games, well, there's the upcoming Disney Infinity Marvel Super Heroes due out in a few months, which will star the Avengers. Other than that, I don't think there are any other Avengers games that have been announced yet.
I'm sure when the new film comes out, there'll be at least one new game to tie in with it. Mm. Wouldn't surprise me if there was maybe another LEGO Marvel or LEGO Avengers on the way as well.
Hmm. As for how to make an end portal, well, you can't make one as such, at least not by default. You need to find one in a stronghold and put an Eye of Ender, which are made from combining blaze powder and an ender pearl, into each of the blocks to activate it.
As for how many mods there are, well, I don't know an exact number, but I think the scientific term for it is heaps. And I'm not sure if there's just one which is more popular than all of the rest.
Mm. It really depends on what you want to mod, I guess. Some people like mods that can change the game in interesting ways, like mutant creatures or millionaire.
Mm. Or you might just want one that improves the graphics, like Sonic Ether's Unbelievable Shaders mod. Or you might just want to give yourself instant access to anything and everything by using the Too Many Items mod.
And of course, there's Tekkit, which combines a whole bunch of mods into one package, and that's pretty popular. But anyway, let's move on to this one from Funky Monkey inside a coconut, Victoria. Say it in a French Perth accent, Hex.
Hello, good game. May I ask you two very important questions and one important tip? One, does Portal classify itself as a shooter? Two, will they ever make the old-style Crash Bandicoot games? In not when's the next one. And a tip in Card Wars, you can just change the date on your iOS and you get a new hearts. Thanks, Funky out.
Well, Funky, I don't think Portal really classifies as a shooter.
Well, you do shoot portals.
Well, true, but I just feel like it's really more of a puzzle game. I mean, sure, you shoot portals, but you shoot them at walls and floors and stuff. You never actually shoot anything.
Well, I think you could argue it's a shooter, but yeah, I do agree with you, Hex. If you gave it to someone and said, hey, check out this awesome shooter, they probably wouldn't think it was one.
Mm. Okay, well, as for if they'll make any old-style Crash Bandicoot games, well, we sure hope so, but there doesn't seem to be any plans for a new one at the moment, unfortunately.
Mm, I was
was reading something the other day that said the owners of the Crash franchise, Activision, have to do something with it before 2021 or else they lose the trademark entirely.
Why's that?
Well, it's some kind of legal mumbo-jumbo that basically says you can't own the rights to something and just do nothing with it. So they'll need to either re-release the old ones or make a new one or make a TV show. They just have to do something with it.
Before 2021? That's like ages away.
Yeah, I know. Well, hopefully they will do something with it sooner rather than later.
As for that Card Wars tip, that's very sneaky but good to know. Anyway, let's move on now to this one. It's the last question for today and it's from Absolute Noob, who is from somewhere in New South Wales.
And thank you for that question, Funky Monkey. In honour of your question being so funky, I've actually been coding a little music jitty for you. It's a funky music rhythm. Do you want to hear it?
Yeah.
Ready? Funky music song, do you like it? Isn't it great?
Yeah, it's pretty good.
Thanks. Out now. Dear Good Game, this isn't technically a question, but I wanted to tell you that your why is October the 10th month was incorrect. Julius Augustus Caesar added 2 months to the calendar, which were July and August, after himself, not January and February. Was Darren wrong? He hates being wrong. He always blames his database or solar flares or something. It's always hilarious.
All right, all right. Well, we better get him on the phone so he can, you know, has a chance to explain for himself if he's wrong or right or what's going on.
It's ringing.
Hello, Bartu.
Hi, Darren.
Hi, Darren.
Hello.
Hi, Darren. Darren, the spawnling here says that you were wrong about that stuff you said about the months a while back.
He said you were wrong.
You were incorrect.
Negative. I've cross-checked my databases, and January and February were indeed the additional months added by Numa Pompilius to create a 12-month calendar.
So why do you think Absolute Noob here thought Julius Caesar added in July and August?
Well, they are partially correct. Julius Caesar did reform the calendar slightly by adding 2 days. However, he did not add any new months. Also, July was indeed named after Caesar, as it was the month he was born in. But it was only renamed to honour him after his death. It was originally known as Quintilis, which is Latin for fifth, as it was the fifth month, so clearly not a new month.
Well, what about August then? Wasn't that also named after him?
Negative. August was named after Augustus, who was Caesar's adopted son, great-nephew, and successor. Much like July, August was known by its original position within the calendar as Sextili, based on the Latin word for sixth, as it was the sixth month.
Oh, well, that's all very fascinating, Darren. Thank you.
Hey, Darren, why is there no communication experiment for this week?
Well, of course there is. Behold, the telephone! Did you know that telephone was the first device in history to allow people to communicate directly via voice over long distances?
Hang on a sec, Darren, you forgot to program an experiment, didn't you?
Talk about phoning it in, Darren.
Oh, Darren got burned!
Negative! Now there's no time to dilly-dally, we have to review Aperture Tag. Come with me if you want to live. Barjo, could you help me with this portal gun? My pastor scoops have trouble firing it. But I've programmed it already, ready to go.
Okay, well, I guess that's all the time we have for this week. And as always, don't forget to send in your questions here. Let's go!
Okay. Through the portal! For science!
It always makes me feel a little bit sick. Oh, Darren, this isn't the studio.
It'll have to do for now. I don't think I can portal again. Stand by for RoboSpew!
No, Darren!
RoboSpew!
No. Don't you do it, Darren!
Darren, you poor thing! Let's get stuck into this review and that'll take your mind off it. Aperture Tag takes us back to the infamous Aperture Science Labs, only this time we're thinking without portals. Portal 2 is one of our favourite games ever, and one of the few games that we've given a perfect score of double 10 rubber chickens. Seeing Aperture Tag pop up had us excited to get back into the lab.
Aperture Tag is a mod of Portal 2 made by fans of the series. It's not a standalone download though, you will need to own Portal 2 to be able to play it.
Mod is short for modification, and it means the developers have changed the original code of the game to make it operate differently. Most mods are free, so I was surprised to see a price tag attached to this game, particularly since there are already so many free Portal 2 levels available online.
Well, the developers try to justify this by not just delivering levels, but an entirely new Aperture adventure. It's all very familiar at the start. You wake up to the sound of a detached voice that gleefully encourages you while also guiding you towards the deadly test chambers.
I know that bed might look comfy. But we've got much to do, so please exit your room.
After a while, you'll meet the face that's attached to the voice that's been guiding you, Nigel. And while he may look a lot like our old friend Wheatley, sadly he is far from it.
Sometimes I wish I had legs so I could do what you do, but then I remember the other things we do to test subjects.
I found the voice acting and the writing to be a bit underwhelming.
I agree, Barjo. Of course, not all robots harbour a dashing, sophisticated and personable operating system like me, but Nigel is just bland.
Okay, I know you're wondering what you are holding. Don't worry, it'll all make sense as we progress.
It's clear that the writers have tried hard to mimic Portal's style of humour, but unfortunately, all of the jokes fall flat.
Yeah, there are some cringeworthy gags, aren't there? But humour is only part of what makes the Portal games great. The rest is the puzzles. But of course, there's one very big difference between this mod and the Portal series. There's no portal gun.
Affirmative. This is all about the bounce and speed gels that were introduced in Portal 2. Once you've collected your fancy new gel gun, you're ready to get painting. Blue gel lets you jump higher, and you can bounce off it like a trampoline. And orange gel gives you a speed boost when you run across it.
There are 27 levels to beat across 4 chapters, but the first chapter feels like a big tutorial, which is a bit strange considering 99% of people playing this mod would probably have played through Portal 2. I appreciate the refresher course, but it just took way too long to get to the meatier puzzles.
I agree. However, once you get through all that, there are some genuinely difficult puzzles which make good use of the two gels and require some skilled timing. The game can be pretty tough in some sections, but there's a good checkpoint system, so you're free to experiment with trial and error.
There are also some clever new additions, such as the Fizzler. This is a force field which disables one or both of your gels as you pass through it. By limiting your gel-laying abilities, the game forces you to think differently about obstacles.
And how fun is that speed run?
If you stop for even a second, you are a dead test subject. No time to lose. Go!
This is a timed skill level which sees you surfing your way through a deadly gauntlet. It's pretty tricky, but super satisfying.
Yeah, my only issue with that level is that there should have been more of them. It's in these moments that the game feels like Portal, and that's a good thing.
But what are you guys going to give it?
Well, Aperture Tag is at its best when it's making you think hard and work harder, but I just didn't feel like that happened enough in the 4 hours or so of gameplay, so I'm giving it 6 rubber chickens.
I think the story and characters are the game's weak points, and that's a real shame because that's what was supposed to set this apart from all the other Portal mods. It's hard to justify this purchase. I'm giving it 5. Well, sadly, that's all the time we have for this week.
But you know what that means.
It's time for me to give the answer to my challenge. Earlier, I asked you which Disney Infinity villain was hiding behind this silhouette. The answer is Syndrome, an evil genius who attempted to defeat the Incredibles with his mastery of technology.
Thanks for that, Darren. Next time on the show, we'll test our molecule-making skills in Circobond.
And don't forget, Spawnlings, our top 100 games of all time special will be on our grown-up show on ABC2 this coming Tuesday night at 8:30 p.m. Find out where your favourites came. Oh, but don't forget to check with your grown-ups if you can watch the show.
Until next time, may all your games be good ones. Hex out.
Barjo out.
Darren out.
So, shall we portal out of here?
Let's go.
Negative. The very thought of it makes me queasier.
Don't do it, Darren.
Here we go.